Hi guys, welcome to another episode of TA Outdoors, and this one's going to be a bit of a bushcraft and fishing special. We're here at a trout fishery, Abington Trout Fishery.
In Hampshire,
yep. And we're basically going to try and catch a trout, show you how we've caught it, hopefully this is, gut it, fillet it, clean it, cook it up at camp, and hopefully have a nice tasty meal.
Well, fingers crossed, but listen, there's also a way of catching trout, which is with a fly rod. So you're trying to sort of imitate an insect or something in the water, and what we're going to do is going to walk down. They've got three lakes here at Abington, set in the heart of Hampshire, chalk springs, it's all clear water here. Most of the time you can see the trout, and you can actually spot the individual trout that you want to catch. Now listen, it doesn't mean to say he's going to take it, does it?
No, it doesn't, no. They're pretty smart trout here.
The bigger they get, the cuter they get. So when you go trout fishing, well, we're speaking here in the UK, everywhere is different trout in the world that can be caught with different techniques. But here in England, we predominate with what's called fly fishing. That's using artificial fly, isn't it?
Yeah.
An insect. And for that, we're going to give you an average of what you might want to use for trout fishing. It's a fly rod, a two-piece, around 9 to 9.6 long, has a cork handle, it has a reel, and some of you guys might notice the reel on this is at the bottom of the rod, not up here. You're not winding it like a spinning reel or anything like that. You've
right
got it
at the bottom
because it's out of the way for when you're casting, because you are casting with nothing on the line except the fly. So your casting weight, if I could describe it as such, is the weight or density of the fly line.
Not the fly itself.
No.
As you would with lure fishing, you'd use the lure as the weight.
Exactly.
This is all about the line is the weight.
No float, no leads, no weights, no spinners, no lures, nothing like that. To get this line out, to get your fly out there, I'm going to give you the basics. We're not going to give a whole breakdown on casting.
That's on TA Fishing if you want to watch
that. It's on TA Fishing if you really want to get into it. There's a whole section with different bits on casting. But basically, you're going to be swishing it backwards and forwards like this, hopefully not hooking your son in the ear.
Yeah.
Waiting like this, and eventually you'll let more and more line off until you get it out far enough and you make your cast. You then let the fly sink through the water so it looks like a natural insect if you can, and you retrieve it. Can be fast, can be slow.
Depends on what the fish want on the day.
Can be static if you're dry fly fishing, okay? So this also has a, I'm gonna call it, well it's an AFTM rating, but we won't go into that, but it's called a rated rod. On average, I'm gonna say a 7 to 8 weight rod, and maybe matching a 7 to 8 weight line. If you are a beginner, I would strongly recommend going to what's called a forward taper line, whereby the majority, the weight, the density, if I'm trying to explain it to you, is at the forward end of the line. So you can imagine that gives you plenty of casting weight.
Yeah.
It sends and unrolls that fly out over the water. Reels can be anything, trust me. These are just regular, cheap,
these are nice
homemade,
old school reels.
40-year-old outfits.
They do the job. It's a storage device at the end of the day. The most important bit of probably most people's fly fishing is got to be the end tackle, and that's the fly itself. And Dad's just going to run through what he's got in his fly box.
These. All trout fishermen must have one of these. A full trout fly box with as many different flies as you can get in there, the majority of which probably won't catch you anything, probably will cost you good money, and probably end up getting stuck in the trees. But listen, hey ho, all you trout fishermen out there, hey, I'm preaching to the converted, you know that. For those who don't know, there's sort of three different types of flies, and this is what they are. The first stage, I would say, is an insect hatching out underneath the water, wriggling its way to the surface to turn into a fly. It flies away, it lives however long it lives, it comes back to the water, lays its eggs, and the whole cycle starts again. For that, you need something like these. These are called nymphs. That's a nymph in the stage before it's turned out into a fly on the surface, and these will be sort of subsurface, quite small hooks. You'll notice they're small hooks and they're very, very small. Just pop one out there, you can see it like that. There's the hook. Now that, believe it or not, imitates a shrimp. That's what it's supposed to imitate. And it goes that way up like that, just goes like that. So there's plenty of shrimp, so we might end up using something like a shrimp during the day trying to catch these trout. You can on some waters use what's called a lure. They are like deranged cocaine addict budgerigars. Yes, they are big, and you can see here very, very fibrous, But this fibre, if I just wet it, this is called marabou. Look, as soon as it wets, it goes down to nothing. But this wiggles and waves like a fish's tail in the water. So basically, a lure will be something that imitates, I'm going to say, another fish, just to give you an idea. Some of these are used for different species, but on average, those would be something like you would be using. Some have weights in the head there. Now you can see this marabou is very fine fibers, but if I just wet it, do not put the hook in your mouth, I just wet it with a bit of spit, immediately it goes down, and underwater that looks like a fish's tail. So that's another type. The third type is when the insect gets to the surface from the nymph stage and hatches into a fly. Now here's one. This is a, oh, God knows how old this is, probably 40, 50, 60, even a lot older than that. But you can see, I've used that one there to show you, it does in fact have wings to it. You see somebody has tied that delicately, a perfect match of a species of mayfly. So those nymphs I told you about earlier hatch into a fly, and for those, you don't crush them all in one big box, you keep them in a special box like this, so they're all dry and they float on the surface just like this, on top of the surface film, and then you actually visually see the trout come up and take that off the surface. That is deemed the pinnacle of fly fishing, of trout fishing in England, is to be able to catch a trout on a dry fly. Today we're going to hopefully catch a trout on a nymph. These are mayfly nymphs. Some of you might say, what are the names? They all have different wings. This one, for instance, here is what's called a spent fly, because the wings, as you imagine, if a fly dies and lays its eggs, its wings are dead, they lay flat. So those are supposed to be wings that lay on the surface and would look to the trout from beneath, if they're looking up to the surface, like a dead, easy sucker meal of a dead fly. That gives you a rough breakdown, very rough. Look, there's thousands of different patterns. It's up to you to work out which ones work on the day. A lot of it is guesswork. Two other things you're going to need. You're going to need a net to net the trout with. It's quite handy to have a folding one like this that opens out. Then you can clip it on the side of your belt, walk around the fishery. And of course, what else are we going to do? Hang on, we're outdoors people. We're going to eat a trout. We're going to cook it and eat it. We're going to catch it, kill it, cook it. Well, we get into the catch it stage in a minute with these flies, then we get to this stage, the kill it stage, that stage. This is called a priest. It could be a piece of wood, it could be a piece of metal. You can pay hardly anything for them. You can make your own, as I did, machine this at the age of 14 when I was at my school in metalwork classes. So that's how old this one is, 50 years old, just a piece of mild steel. That's used for whacking the fish on the head, one or two whacks, all over and done with, and then you can gut it, clean it, or go catch another one, prepare it. So we are now ready to go and try and catch a trout, after which it's going to be meeting Mr. Priest.
Oh yes, finally guys. Oh, it's quite a decent fish, it's a decent trout. We've switched flies, we've gone to larger nymphs, it's been really tough. And the weeds starting to come up where the sun's so strong today. We're about early springtime, we're coming into mid-spring now. And they just weren't having it, they were following our small nymphs in. But we just thought, do you know what, let's change things up a bit. So as in true English fashion, we went back to the car and had a cup of tea. And then had a think, and we thought, let's put on some bigger nymphs, because it might switch them on and make them a bit more aggressive. And lo and behold, I've had two really fast follows, and now this one just absolutely bolted, and I had too much slack line. This is a really good trout, Dad, you know?
Took a second time, didn't it?
Yeah, I missed him, and then I plonked my fly back out, and he absolutely munched it.
If you get him in, that's not just going to feed us, it's going to feed a whole trout.
Yeah, this is getting cooked up at camp, definitely, man, if we can land it.
Lift.
Yes. Woohoo! That's a nice trout.
That's a big trout, yeah.
That's a nice trout, man. Look at that. Look at that. Now to dispatch. There we go. Right, gonna use the old priest, guys. Between the eyes, generally where their brain is, just a couple of good hits if we keep them still. There you go, that's all it needs. As you can see, guys, the fly's just in his mouth here. I've just dispatched the fish with the priest. There's the fly we've been using, a bigger nymph with a gold weighted bead at the head just to get it down in the water column a bit quicker. Look at the lovely vermilion stripe colours going across it. That is one healthy rainbow trout, and that's gonna make hopefully one healthy Mike after eating it. Beautiful fish. How big do you reckon, Dad?
Five plus.
It's a lovely looking fish. I mean, that's going to feed me and you quite easily at camp, isn't it? And some.
Mum, sister, dog.
Beauty. Absolute beauty.
Chickens.
Chickens here, yeah. Well, this was caught on real small tweaks. I like to call them the 1-inch tweak, but fast. So fast, fairly fast tweaks, just little jigs, and he absolutely hammered it. So we're going to gut it, clean it, prep it, ready for the campfire. Well, guys, now I've dispatched this fish, I'm going to put it on what's called a stringer, which is just this, literally a chain with a clip here that goes through the mouth, through the gills, the gill plate just there, the gill cover, out through the mouth, and then you lock it in place like that. This fish then goes in the water to keep it fresh because we want to eat it later. So it's gone in the margins of the lake here. At the end of the stringer is a spike, and you stake that into the ground. That way, if anything else goes to try and run off with it, it's locked into the ground and the fish just sits there, and we have fresh fish to eat later and we can carry on fishing.
Well, my goodness, that took a bit of time to get this one hooked up, and I actually had to stand up on these huge grassy clumps they've got down here where I'm standing to give me a bit of height so I can actually watch them in this clear water. Because what's happening is we've got this what we call white cloud, which is not good when it reflects. Oh, when it reflects off the water surface, it makes it really difficult. Wow, he's going now. Makes it really difficult for spotting the fish. So I got up high and I can see through the water better. And he came and looked at it twice. Look, we haven't got it yet, as we say. Nice fish. You know what I did? I changed over to the same fly Mike was using, called a Pearly Daddy, slightly bigger nymph. There's another trout following that one around. That's a brownie, looks like a brownie. This is a nice rainbow. He's pulling me all the way back up again. Come on, fish, just want to get it in. All you fishermen out there know you just want to get it in. Let's extend this net. Right, there's my chance. Let's see if I go in with it. Not giving up. English rainbow trout fishing at its best. Word, is he scrapping? Yes, sir. Yes, I say that one, guys. We all know that's bigger than Mike's one, don't we? Straight between the eyes. He's done. That's it. They quiver, but that's just their nerves. That's all it is. But what a magnificent looking rainbow trout that is. I mean, we say it's hard fishing, but we got one good one each and a bonus grayling out the river. You cannot say that's not good fishing. Beautiful conditions, late spring. Do we keep fishing or we get up the campsite? What should we do? Keep fishing for a little keep
bit.
Keep fishing.
Keep fishing for a bit, yeah. It's a beauty.
Well, this, people, is the gin clear quality. Look at the gravel here. I've put that camera down a bit. You can see beautiful clear gravel. Lovely lush streamer weed in here for the fish. You can actually see a trout laying under that bridge there. Impossible to get a casting angle. I'm going to go and walk around, see if I can see an angle on this. Let's just carefully have a look on the bridge. Always creep on the bridge. Oh my God, just spooked a rainbow down there. You might even have seen it on camera. But lovely clear water. My goodness, makes you want to go fishing. And I don't see any fish here, but I did spook one going across there. I might just have a look on the other side. Oh, there's one under the bridge. Isn't there always? Isn't there always? Well, guys, hooked up here. I'm down on that side stream, the carrier beat. I don't know whether I get this one out. Swing him out. He's going to be too small for the Barbie. But, oh my God. Oh, look at this, people. This is, by the way, guys, a grayling here in England. And you can see his big dorsal fin there. Look. You see the big dorsal fin up there. Now, you can eat these. They're allegedly supposed to, if I don't drop it. I think they're supposed to smell of thyme or cucumber or something, but a real pretty fish. Gonna put this one back. You can eat them. I'm not going to eat them. Mike's got that big rainbow. But what a pleasure to catch a pretty fish like that. That's a nice one. There. Let's get him back.
Oh, I got a perch. Yeah. I have. Perch city. That, everybody, is a perch. We don't eat them usually over here in the UK, but they're meant to be very tasty fish for those that have eaten them. Personally, my favourite UK freshwater fish is the perch. Awesome little predator. Really, really cool fish. You can see he's got the white chomper fly just there. Almost like a maggot to them. They have spikes here on the edge of their gill plate. They have spines on the top of their dorsal here. All of these are spines as well. So watch out for that when you're unhooking them.
Well guys, I am going to be filleting this fish with a new knife that I got. My buddy Tim, who lives in Hampshire, he's a fellow Hampshireman, he's a knife maker, and he's given me to test out one of his Field and Fish knives. So it's a little, basically like a field knife, and it's a Scandinavian grind, as you can see. It's 01 tool steel. It's only small, it's about 3 inches. I don't know the full specs. I'll pop them in the video description for you, but he does a lovely polished finish to it there with his Ammonite logo and this kind of almost like the laminate stock you get on some of the rifles that you can see. But real good quality tool steel, probably about 3 mil thick. But we're gonna test this out on this trout that I've just caught here, which we're then gonna take to camp and cook away. We're not sure what recipe we're gonna use yet, but we'll cook it up anyway. Blimey, that is sharp. Brain surgery. Cut that. You know, that's really sharp, that. It's all the guts. Saw down this bit, try to get as close to the backbone as possible. Obviously be aware of your fingers here, people. Well, there we go, guys. There's two fillets off that nice trout that I caught. We have two other trout that we have caught, which we're still going to fillet and probably freeze them. But Dad, as he said, is going to use the guts, all of this lot, for his shark fishing over this summer. Don't waste anything, guys. You can use these for baits on fishing hooks as well to catch more fish. But I'm going to go and rinse these in the river now. Thanks very much, Tim. This is a pretty awesome knife. I'll pop everything about this little knife in the video description for you guys to take a look at.
It's all very well, guys, filleting like Mike did with that knife. I've got a knife, you have never seen it. I promise you, it is the only one in the world. It's handmade. I'm going to attempt, wait for this, to gut and fillet this fish. I've no idea whether it's going to work with this. Now, I think it might be a roe deer antler.
That is awesome.
Yeah, and I'm going to show you just after I've done this one. You'll be able to look at how I've prepared this. I'm going to try. It's a gamble. You've probably seen our full shark knife, the primitive one. How about one? I'm going to try and gut and fillet this fish with one shark tooth.
And what shark is that?
That's a tiger shark tooth. It's got that little kink in it. I've no idea whether it'll work. It's a total experiment. I just feel it will. So, and it's beautiful. I personally think I've ground this off. You'll see when you look at the little clip of how I made this, the sort of things you can do. And you can see why people use bones and antlers. That, what caught me was that curve, because I thought that's a really good curve.
Look, natural.
It is ergonomic, an ergonomic deer bone antler. And of course I've got the curve that way. So let's see if the old girl cuts. I've got to get probably in here, I should think. Once I get that first break in, there. Oh my God,
what?
Good job, my finger wasn't in
that
front.
That actually sliced it.
It went off at a tangent then. And, oh look, oh my God. That way.
Yeah.
Oh look, it's just gone. That is, look at that, guys.
What have we got in there?
Whoa, lovely jubbly. Livers, kidneys, heart. Look at this. Get your hand in there. All you squeamish ones.
Yeah. People that eat fish and chips at the shop,
yeah.
There's a bit of a process it goes through before you actually heat it.
What I'm going to do is, because look, I don't want to take my finger off because this is sharp. I'm going to try. Oh, it does it. It just pops through. Oh,
yeah.
My God, look. Obviously, if you're out bushcrafting in the wild,
you're surviving,
wild environment,
you'd eat that.
Yeah. Look, we're not talking survival. We're talking, this is going in to biodegrade naturally. Other fish are going to eat that anyway. Naturally, obviously, you would be eating this if you're in a survival situation. I'll call it kidneys at the back here. I'm going to see if it cuts through that.
That thing.
Membrane. It does indeed. And then we'll take all this out. Tell you what I'm going to do, guys. I'm going to. This is really good for shark fishing, this stuff. Look at this.
Fresh blood.
Oh, some people think that's a bit rank, but trust me, shark fishing would love that. Let's wash him off and I'll see if I can fill it at least one side of this. Look, it's lovely and clean now. Some people like taking the gills out. You know, here, you can cut the gills out, keep it fresher, fine. Everybody's got a different way of doing it. All I'm saying is why, because I'm going to take the fillets off. Fingers crossed. Just going to go. The thing is, if you have a long blade like Mike had, you can feel along the edge of the backbone. And that is obviously going to be tricky for me to do with this knife. Yeah.
You caught that shark?
Yeah, years and years ago, about 35 years ago.
How big was it?
I think it's about 300 pounds, I can't honestly remember. The skipper decided he wanted to take it in and eat it. Nowadays, we release them all. It's using, look, guys, please don't email in about all the meat I'm wasting. We will not waste any of this meat because I use it for shark fishing as well. I just want to see if this knife will cut. Now I can find the backbone. But if you were in a survival situation,
you caught a shark.
Yeah, and you caught a shark in the... First problem is, you wouldn't be in much of a survival situation trying to catch a shark in the first place.
Oh, you could have netted it, gill net.
Well, no, they catch them in form. This is for, you think, look at that. You can actually, look,
I've
never done this before. Oh man, it does cut. I'm just very, very wary.
Yeah,
because it's so short
yourself.
Of my fingers. It's definitely cuts, look. When you get it on that small outside edge, look, straight through.
You could skin stuff quite, it's like a skinning knife.
It's like a sort of skinning, I'm just going to try here, look. This is just practice, this is, guys. Yeah, it does.
Skinning knife,
that's more, you could use that for skinning. Yeah.
Yeah.
There we go.
Look at that.
Just stroking it. Look, you can't see it doesn't cut, it's wide open. I'm just very wary, because one wrong slip with this puppy here, and it's off to the accident and emergency. Look, guys, there you go. I know it's not a tidy fillet. I know it's not. It's going to be washed. It's all food. It's edible. Of course, with Mike's filleting knife and cutting knife, anything with a wide ball blade, you're going to get it. But look at that. A single shark tooth mounted into a deer antler. Trust me, I've just made it up. You've never seen that before, I'm sure. Tiger shark tooth in a deer antler. Does it do the job? I think so.
Here we go, chaps. Curried rainbow trout.
Curried rainbow trout.
It smells incredible. I have to admit, it really does. Taste?
The beer batter is making it really crispy.
Oh, it does, doesn't it?
Mmm. And what it does, you see there, guys, it locks, and it's still steaming. It locks the moisture into the fish. Rather than if you put the fish straight into the pan, it's totally different. This way the batter is a seal around it and keeps it moist.
Mm.
I've probably overcooked it a bit because you're out in the camp, you want to make sure stuff's cooked. It's certainly hot.
Still really nice though, chap. Really nice.
Mm.
And what we've done is put a bit of Italian seasoning on the rice,
just
to give the rice, because rice on its own is pretty bland. So we've given the rice a bit of flavouring as well.
And that's just a regular cook in the bag.
Mm.
You must be able to get them all around the country, all over the world, I guess, to do cook in the bag.
Boil in the bag.
Make life easy.
It's lovely.
This one was cooked for, depends on how hot you get that oil, about 7 minutes.
Not long, was it?
Seven, eight, 9 minutes, something like that. If there's any chefy types out there, they're going to tell me 5 minutes. If you overcooked it, I'd sooner overcook it, lose a little bit of moisture, and not be ill. Look, we haven't been on this, guys. It was like caught straight away.
It's fresh.
Caught yesterday, it's fresh. And we caught it by our own fair hand.
Plastic mug. I think your plastic cup's more famous than the cooks, Dad.
Guys, you've got the old coffee going. I've got a coffee in the old cookser. Dad's got the classic plastic mug that he brings out every time, which is probably the most famous thing on YouTube right now.
Countryside cooking, I love it.
Yeah. How did we cook that? That was really nice, that rainbow trout, but I don't know how Dad prepared the recipe.
It was good, it was good. You need plain flour. You just need a little bit of plain flour, not self-raising. Then what you're going to do is you're going to sort of lighten it. You're going to break it up by scattering that flour through a sieve. It makes it finer, it makes a better batter, basically. After that, what we do anyway is put 1 tablespoonful of oil in there. No, not Duckham's 2050, just regular sunflower oil, something like that. Then we added to that 1 tablespoonful of curry powder. Now that was a medium curry powder. You can obviously put whatever strength of curry you want in there. I suppose I could have put a little bit extra in that one, but I was worried I was going to overkill it for Mike. It's a very tender stomach. So we're going to be using beer batter. Now, going to be using ale as opposed to lager. Lager just doesn't have the same taste. It doesn't give the same consistency as some good old-fashioned ale. So we're going to use some beer. You're going to be stirring constantly. The important thing, I was told this by Wayne, our fish recipe and cook guy, don't make the batter too runny. You want it a sort of consistency, he said, of, say, emulsion paint, just regular paint. Keep mixing it either with a whisk or a fork and get it to a nice, smoothy, creamy consistency. Then all you've got to do is put it in a sealed container and take it to your camp with you. As for the fish, I'd already diced the fish up. It's already been filleted and we've diced it all up into what we call sort of goujon size, really. When you get to the camp, all you got to do is just dab it dry, those pieces of fish, with some paper, dip it into the batter, coat that piece of meat either side of the batter, and don't drop it, just slowly lower it into the fat, the cooking oil we got there. But make sure, because you won't see it bubbling a lot of time, the cooking oil, so you might have to test dip a little piece of batter with fish into a corner first, make sure it's hot enough. When it sizzles and bubbling, then you know it's hot enough, and try and get all the pieces in there pretty quickly, because the first piece and the 21st piece will be cooked at different rates.
Well, chaps, it's the getting towards the end of our video now, so those of you who've stuck with us all this way, we'd like to say thank you very much for continuing to watch it. At this stage in our videos, myself and the old nut over here tend to do what's called theory time. We throw a theory out there and you guys hopefully give us some feedback on the old comments and let us know your thoughts, because it's a place where you can share your thoughts and opinions. And the theory time, that the topic, sorry, that this one's going to be focused on is, we've gone out, we've caught our trout with modern gear that's made by modern technology, and you know, yes, there's the watercraft knowledge needed up here, but most of it, of what we used, is all man-made. How did they do it in the primitive era, years
exactly,
ago?
Yeah, yeah.
We want to know, how do you think they caught the first fish? The first guy out there must have been a good fisherman. How did they catch the first fish? We've got different methods of doing it. The first thing that springs to mind for me was the classic spear that you can make, the primitive spear.
With the three prongs like that?
Yeah.
That sort of three prong.
Yeah, they wedge,
out.
They wedge it open,
wedge
don't
it out,
they?
Yeah, that could have been. I mean, well, would they have made those sort of basket type traps?
Wicker basket
like
traps,
a wicker basket,
yeah.
Conical trap.
Yeah.
Would they have dammed it in some way? You know,
that's,
what
that's quite a good way, yeah. Maybe they dammed the water, if it's a river as such, maybe they dammed the water so that it flowed out. And then got a group of them there ready to catch the fish.
Actually, I got one popped in my head just then.
What's that?
Oh, God. Well, hang on, after the dinosaurs, let's say they were meat eaters, well, if the dinosaurs died out, and a lot of the other prey that they were, that we were all that came and were eating meat, maybe there's a transition time that they actually went and started and had to look for fish because there was no animals, they'd been wiped out by a meteorite. I never thought of that before, you know? Is that a transition
true
from, there is no meat, then we've got to start eating vegetables and or fish.
Yeah.
Who knows?
That's so true. This is why we throw these wacky theories out there, guys, because it's one of those things where you go, actually,
because we're wacky.
What is the answer to that? You know, I know there's anthropology, which is the study of, you know, the primitive man and things like that, but what we want to know your opinion. We're just normal guys. We're not the experts. We're not professional experts. We always say that. We're just a father and son coming out and messing around.
Look, we just like a lot of you guys out there.
Yeah.
We just like going outside, lighting the fire,
and
having
cooking.
Some food, cooking, enjoying all the stuff that all the other experts do. And of course, a lot of you out there are just ordinary people. You just want to go out in the outdoors, enjoy it.
Well, guys, thank you very much for watching the video. If you've enjoyed it, please hit the thumbs up button. And if you're not subscribed already, please do hit the subscribe button so you can get notified whenever we upload these awesome videos.
Also, don't forget. Also, don't forget, if you build the fire up too much, you get a lot of ash going into your cup of tea and you end up choking. That's something to remember, isn't it? Don't forget, watch the totally awesome, well, fishing show.
TA Fishing, yeah.
We go fishing, so that's what we do, really. That's what I do.
If you want to learn how to fish, guys, this has been predominantly a fishing episode. If you want to learn how to fish and you're a beginner or you're experienced and you want to learn more tips about fishing, Dad runs the TA Fishing Show. It's got 120,000 subscribers, 28 million views.
28 million?
It's really, really popular.
Just had a silver button from
YouTube. Yeah, we just got our
YouTube
silver play button come through for it. So check it out. There's loads of tips on there.
And also, you can watch or download the awesome Angler magazine.
Yeah, our free.
Mike runs, I don't do it, Mike does all this as well as the filming.
As well as YouTube, yeah.
And that's getting bigger and bigger. It's gone to what?
10,000 downloads on
first
issue one, about 5,000 on issue
it's
two.
Going, that's going mad.
It's bi-monthly, it's free to download. Yeah, enjoy it, guys. Thank you very, very much for watching the show.
And we'll see you again out in the woods somewhere or on the riverbank. Let's check this out. This one's got to go home with me. I mean, just look at that. Part of a horn, skull, probably got better teeth than I have, I should think. But what type? Roe deer? I don't know. Fallow deer? Who knows? One thing is it is a very dead deer. I shall take that and bear it back with pride to my wife, who will now no doubt treat it with disdain.
So here's a little clip on how Graham made his awesome shark tooth knife. First thing he did was get rid of this horn here, nice ergonomic grip to it. We noticed this stitching in the skull at the top here, perhaps you guys can let us know why it's kind of more reinforced up there. So just using a hacksaw, obviously be careful of your fingers, safety first guys. Graham chopped off the horn. The next thing he did was cut off the secondary horn with a hacksaw again, and that makes it for a much easier grip. Now he used sandpaper here, and he was telling me that although it did work, it was very time consuming and the bone was very hard. So what he had to resort to really was using a grinder.
because there was lots of sharp bits on the edge of the horn there. So he's using his grinder here just to burn off basically any protruding bits to make it a much more comfortable grip. And then here he's just making a V notch, which he's going to use to put the shark tooth in. He's just making a mark down the middle there so that it's nice and straight and aligned. Just testing the tiger shark tooth there to check that it fits, and he's left it protruding from the side and so that it sticks out as much as possible and gives you the greatest possibility of cutting. Then simply use the two-part epoxy to get the tooth set in the antler itself, and then let it dry and it's ready to go.